See, I have this theory about a certain type of player. Like a Ron Coote, a Steve Menzies, a Gordon Tallis. I call it the sparkly-eyed man. He's a guy who can be as vicious as he needs to be. He can do anything he needs to do during the course of that 80 minutes to bring a result towards his team. His will to win rises to any occasion. But the moment that final whistle's blown, he's a completely different man. He's able to laugh easily. He's good with kids, respectful to women. He appreciates life and he's grateful, which is, of course, why he's the sparkly-eyed man. He has that thing built within him to never quit. And if you're going to do something, you do it to the absolute utmost of your ability. Those sparkly-eyed men, they carve their name deep in rugby league.
South Sydney Rabbitohs, pride of the National Rugby League. It's been a long journey getting to this point, but now we've met and we both share the same ambition. That's my brother Luke, he's the eldest. There's the twins, Thomas, and this is George. Tomorrow night will forever become part of South's history when for the first time in over 100 years, four brothers will line up for the same team at the same time. Oh, and that's me, Sam Burgess. But the lads, they call me Slammin.
Get that in here. Wow.
Oh, good shot. The torso stopped, the legs kept going, and it was Big Sam. And those Burgess have hit him with everything, including his birth certificate.
Always willing to put his body on the line for the sake to, you know, to win a game.
I know when he crosses that white line that the opposition are always looking out the corner of eye for Big Sammy.
I think he's just a complete footballer. He's got a really good football brain. He's big, he's fast, he's skillful, he's aggressive.
The things that he does for the team, the cleaning up of loose balls and he'll dive on grenades. while you've got those sorts of players, it's great to be able to build teams around those people.
At 18 years of age, he was such a dominant forward. He was raw, but had no fear. Played with a huge passion, was never beaten.
Yeah, mate, there's all this hype about this new kid coming out and playing for England, name was Sam Burgess, and we sort of seen a bit of highlights in that of him, and then all of a sudden I think within his first touch, he scored a try.
Back on the inside, Burgess bounces it down.
Mate, that was a bunch of wimps, to be honest.
Now he's stepping off his right foot. He might go all the way, Sam.
What he brought to us is he has an incredible work ethic. You don't see many forwards in defence being involved in four of the tackles in one set of six.
Just the mental toughness that he has, seen him down and out in games where you think, you know, you're probably going to have to take him off, but he just finds a way to get himself to the next effort.
I really, really like this kid. You South Sydney fans are very, very lucky.
People talk about Sam Burgess becoming the greatest English forward to ever come to Australia. To me, that's a slight against Sam Burgess. The reality is, I think Sam Burgess could become the greatest forward to ever play in our game.
Back there, back there, back there.
They want to keep it zipping out wide. They've got the quality.
So we just finished last training session before the game tomorrow night. We call it game prep or captain's run. It's a quick sort of 50-minute session. We just run through our players and try and sharpen things up before the big game tomorrow night. I've got into a ritual of cooking spaghetti bolognese and eating just as much food as I possibly can the night before a game. When we're playing in Sydney, and my brothers love it, my mum comes and joins in and make a sort of, it's been a routine for ever since probably, you know, I moved to Australia. So that's where we're going now, and you'll see how much food we eat now before a game. It's pretty it's pretty impressive.
Where are you going, lad?
No, we're just going back to mine for a feed, lad.
Have you cooked up a good feed tonight?
Yeah, big feed tonight. George, why are you always the last out of the showers?
Always last.
I have to look my best.
All right, see you there, boys. Yeah. Mate, we're always together everywhere. So we finish training, we go for a coffee together. So it's, you know, it's great. I think it's really, you know, worn off into the team a little bit as well. Like, you know, the family environment. Me and my brothers, we're all playing tomorrow. There's been a lot made of it all week. You know, throughout the media and everything. It's something, you know, as a group of brothers, we've always wanted to do. And certainly tomorrow's going to be a special day and one that I think we'll remember for a long time.
Hey.
How are you doing?
Good.
Hi.
Hi.
I had the sniffer dog sniffing my bag.
Oh, what are you carrying in?
Oh, crazy.
Just a bug.
Hello.
Where's George?
Oh, sorry, George. Oh,
yeah. I am a bit hard to miss.
Right, let's do this. Lolly, you saying Grace?
Ambience of us all being together. And we thank you for all this, dear Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Nani. Thank you, Nani.
Best one yet.
Oh, here we go. Best one yet.
I wonder if we'll all get on at the same time.
Could be.
I think if we've gone out, I'll put it on.
Yeah.
It'll put me in the back.
Yeah. These four men,
these
four young people. Oh, that's nice. Can we rewind it?
No.
Oh, what's that?
Julie,
that's sweet. I did not.
Julie on camera.
That's last week, because that was that new top that I bought.
Julie B on camera loves it.
Oh, Sammy, that's stupid.
I never ever thought that it was going to end up like this. I never ever thought that we'd all end up here, ever. I just thought it was Sam's choice to come and live in Australia. And then George dropped the bombshell that he was going to leave, and I thought I was going to die when George left. George sang me a great farewell song that night. I can't deny it. And Tom did his usual rap. And I could not be happier to see them. I'm not going to get emotional or anything, but I could not be happier to see them tomorrow all run out together. Yeah. That is just going to be...
Will you get emotional tomorrow?
Probably.
Yeah. Have a few glasses of wine and then she'll get emotional tomorrow. Yeah.
I just want to get down at the end of the game on pitch side and get a photo of you all together.
Oh, yeah.
Why did you ever think this would ever happen? Did you ever...
I didn't think it would happen this quick.
No, I didn't. I didn't think it would happen this year.
Someone said to me the other day, like, he's got three boys. He said, if one of my boys went on to be a professional footballer, like, it'd be awesome. He said, you look at that. He said, like, there's all four of you. You're all playing professional football. You're going to play together in the NRL. It's, tomorrow to go and compete together is going to be massive. So realising that, it's not been done for 103 years, so it's quite rare.
We're
looking forward to that.
I've spent my whole life going to different grounds to watch you all play at different places. I've gone on a Friday night to watch Luke at Leeds. I've gone to a Sunday to watch you at Bradford. I've gone to watch these play for local teams. Every weekend, I've gone to at least two or three games. Yeah. This weekend, I've just got one game. We're going to play in the same place for the first time ever.
So tomorrow, lad.
What? Oh, boy.
10 o'clock.
Yeah.
See you later.
Bye-bye. See you tomorrow. Yeah.
Get some sleep, eh?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, sweet. I'll give you a call when I'm on my way over.
All right. All right, see you, lad. That's it. The family gone. So I'm just going to clean up and then get to bed. It's game time tomorrow, so I look forward to that. It's a big day. You know, this game is coming around pretty fast, so looking forward to the game tonight. Not nervous. It's a bit of a different feel, though, really. A different sleep last night. I was very conscious of playing with my brothers. My phone's been going mad with, you know, people texting. You know, there's a bit of a different feel around tonight's game, but certainly going to look forward to it. It's going to be good. Go for a swim with the boys, a bit of breakfast, and then we're into it tonight.
Yeah.
You know, we do this every week, especially we're all playing, so we're all here this morning. Boys are on the porridge, I get the poached eggs. And it's just fueling ourselves for tonight, for the game. We do like to eat out on the game day morning. We like to get out of the house. Because especially when you're playing at night, we want the time to go fast. And, you know, we'd rather wake up and play straight away. But, you know, this way, time passes, we go for a swim. It's probably not like the game comes around.
We grew up in a little village called Livesage.
Yeah, it was great, it was very relaxed. There's not very many people live there.
Everyone knows each other.
Everyone knew each other. You walk around the streets, everyone knows everyone. We never moved out as a family. We all stayed there throughout our whole childhood. It was a really cool place to grow up.
Sam was, dare I say it, quite, I would say ugly, but it wasn't the best looking baby with his quite large head. Sorry, Sam.
Still struggling to get rid of it, some of it from his head.
She describes me as like a miniature Buddha. She said I was just so big and fat and always smiling.
He was just a very happy child. He didn't move. He just used to sit. He didn't walk till he was about 18 months old. He didn't talk. He just sat and smiled and ate and laughed and just was happy to just sit with food around him. But his first steps, when he finally stood up to walk, were to kick a ball. And his first words were not mommy, daddy, it was ball. I started playing rugby when I was 30 years old, rugby league. So I started playing when the twins were just after the twins were born and played for 10 years. Sam would have been then 3 years old. Sam would come to every game with me. He would follow me, he would come and watch. He would always ask to come and watch. I've even seen Sam standing behind the posts in Featherston watching me play in snow.
I just used to love going to the footy. It meant I had a football in my hands and I could kick the ball around for 2 hours and not get stopped while my mum's playing herself. I just loved the game so much.
I've always known there was something special about him. Sam was always noticed by everybody as having just something a little bit extra. I think it was that little competitive edge, that will to win, you know, when you just know.
He was picked in all the rep sides and, you know, he was like the golden boy in his age group, so.
Just one thing I used to speak to Sam about is his belief. Just, he always told himself, you know, whenever he stepped out onto a field, that he had that belief that he knew he was stronger than the people that he was running at. Stronger than the people who were tackling and fitter than the people that he were playing against, so.
Oh, I don't know if he'll kill me for saying it. He used to have a Superman T-shirt that he always used to wear underneath his playing kit when he was a junior. And I remember once I think I'd lost it or I'd washed it or put it in the wrong place. And I remember him going absolutely crazy. Where's my Superman shirt? I need that.
As a kid growing up, I used to think when I was playing, I had to do something great in a game. I wanted to try and be the best player on the field. That was just my mentality as a kid. And I guess it kind of stuck with me throughout my career and helped me get to where I am now. The first person I used to speak to after some games was my dad. He was heavily passionate about rugby league. You know, he played himself, not as a full-time professional. He was a front row forwards. When we were all kids, obviously, he was still playing. We used to go and watch. As we got older, my dad started coaching and took us down to Jubilee Rugby Club. Me, Luke and dad and the twins, we were all best mates, you know.
I used to be a builder, massive bloke, massive shoulders, arms, and he just used to make all the other parents look small. I used to think, you know, our dad was like Superman, so you could do anything.
My parents separated when we were youngish, maybe 14, 15, and, you know, I stayed living with my dad.
Basically, almost immediately after that, yeah, it was the diagnosis, yeah, which was horrific.
I didn't understand it at first. I didn't understand what it meant, or the severity of it, of what motor neuron disease was. I'd never heard of it before. I'd never really seen my dad, never seen my dad cry before, never seen him cry. For him to sit us down and you know, struggled to get the words out that that he had motor neuron disease in front of us. It's horrible to find out that, you know, that your dad's going to die. You never believe that.
Sam, at that moment in time, became the main carer for his father and did a great job.
He just didn't want to feel like that, you know, he's a burden on anyone. But unfortunately for the illness that he had, he needed a lot of care, especially in his last few months. To literally carry him to bed, you know, it's 21 stairs to the top, I remember it. That became the norm at home.
He always did it in a really cheerful, a really caring way, and it was the love that Sam had for his father was incredible. Sam was doing really well, and you know, Dad was really proud of him. Dad was really, really proud of him, as we all were. We're all really proud of him, but probably made it really difficult for Sam, you know, trying to care for Dad and, you know, start his own career at the same time.
To distract me from my dad was to go and get in an environment with 30 guys that I've been with for the last 4 years. It just took my mind completely off it. I'd get in there, I'd train, I'd do my weights, and my mind's away from it. And then I'd go out on the field, I'd do football. It's what I enjoy. It's what I needed to keep me straight on the journey.
It was a really difficult time for everyone, and Sam dealt with it probably better than all of us. Sam is an incredibly strong person. You would almost think that he was the father in a way sometimes, because he was incredibly protective of all his brothers at that time, and would worry more about how it was going to affect the twins than how it would affect himself. And he would often say, oh my God, this is too much for the twins, but never for himself.
Things gradually got worse over time, and it kind of sneaks up on you a little bit, and you kind of think, oh, where's that time going? And, you know, it's just sad really, but like you said, things happen in life for reasons, and you know, make you stronger.
You want to take a break?
Yeah.
You know, looking back on it, don't envy what Sam had to do with going into a rugby league team at a young age and looking after my dad as well. So it was very tough. What he did there is made him a very strong person. His mental toughness, you know, when I look at Sam, I just see my dad.
It certainly does change the way you look at the world. To look back and talk about it now is, I'm so glad that it happened that way, where I could, you know, we were always together, you know. That's why it's a bit easier to take.
It all represents my family. This here is Yorkshire, the White Rose. They've got the four, me and my three brothers there. They've got the twins down there, and me and Sam. And just above us all there is like, this is big guardian angel, which represents my dad. He's holding our family crest on the flag there. He's just above us, looking down, looking over us, making sure we're all okay. And this script here on the inside of my arm, this is it's quite a famous poem called Footprints in the Sand by Mary Stevenson. It's one of my mum's favourite poems, and it's special because she read it out at my dad's funeral. You promised me, Lord, that if I followed you, you would walk with me always. But I have noticed that during the most trying periods of my life, there have only been one set of footprints. Why, when I needed you, have you not been there for me? And the Lord replied, the times when you have seen only one set of footprints is when I carried you.
Me and my brothers are, you know, so grounded about everything. We don't get carried away with what or who we are or what we do. You know, we're still very grounded to, you know, living a normal life and and really just appreciating what's important to us, and that's the day you have.
Oh man, we'll go back. Chris played against me. He played for Leeds when I made my debut for Bradford. So Chris played that game, and then
had a couple of years at Bradford together after that.
Chris runs his gym now, and so when I'm trying to get fit before I go into pre-season, work out with the giant. So we call him the big giant.
Try my best.
Try and keep his fit as a big guy, you know.
I made my first grade debut in 2006 for Bradford, and at 17 I was itching to play first team. And for some reason, I thought once I play a game of first grade, that's it, I've made it. And so that's all that was driven. My focus from being 16 was I wanted to play first grade. I really believed that I could make a difference in the first team, that I could add something to the team.
They got him doing some extra weight sessions just to try and get him a little bit bigger and try and get him up to speed. I know he had a target that they wanted him to reach. Yeah, I think he had to bench press his own body weight for 10 reps. That was like his proof that he was strong enough to play first grade. He was weighing about just over 100 kilos. So to do 10 reps at that was quite tough, but you know, he did it.
And I got a phone call at 10 o'clock in the morning from the head coach, Steve McNamara. He said, look, we've got a player that's sick. Do you think he can play tonight? It's a dream come true. So as a kid, I'm fist pumping. Ran downstairs. First person I told was my dad, sit down, you know, I'm playing tonight at Headingley.
His debut was against the team who I played for. I played for Leeds Rhinos and Sam played for Bradford Bulls, and back in England they're arch rivals, it's a local derby.
I remember looking over and seeing Jamie Peacock on the other team, who's a Great Britain captain, you know, a massive figure in the game. As someone I used to love as a kid, you know, and I'm playing against him.
Newton, find Sam Burgess, who's on for his debut. His father Mark here tonight, and he'll be very proud of his son. Danny Williams, big hit from Sam Burgess, knocks him back there.
He went well, you know. He's always been the same. He's never, you know, very consistent, gives 100%, just goes hard every time. Playing with him then, he were a leader. In training, he wanted to be the best all the time. He wanted to lead, like, you know, lead by example. And look, I know when I was 20, I was playing, I was looking up to players thinking, you know, I want to be like that guy. Whereas I think Sam were one of them players that were like, people wanted to look up to him. And I think lads that had played, you know, international players that had played in the same position as him were still looking up to him.
Get ready for the beach, Chris likes to call it, so I can get speedos on down Bondi Beach.
That's the main thing.
On match day, we like to get down to the beach, freshen us up a little bit, get us out of the house. So it makes the day go by faster, and gives us a bit of movement in the legs and some blood flowing in the body.
Yeah, I hope you got some good footage of me catching a few of them peelers.
You know, to see my brothers do so well, especially my younger brothers, Tom and George, to see them do so well, you know, they're only 21 years old. It's a great feeling as an older brother, and to be doing what we do now together is sort of a dream come true.
Going,
doing
good.
Where are
you going? We're going to get French old kids.
No, not that now. I don't get that nervous as a player. It's that time switching on. Put your mind on the game now, and it's game time pretty soon. Yeah, the phone's been going off all day. Mark Kyle, work hard, bud. First try scorer. Take them on, back yourself. Yeah, it's from Mark Carroll, and I'm good friends with him. He used to play at South and Manly. You know, Russell sent through his text as well. He sends his usual text of encouragement, which is always nice. It's sinking in now more, and you know, become a bit of a reality what's going to happen tonight. And the size of what we're doing is, you know, it's pretty big. 2007, probably my best year of football in England was that year. That's when I went and played for Great Britain, you know, sort of 3 months after my dad passed away. It was a strange year because there's so much sadness in my life. You know, so much heartache, and then on the other hand, there's so much joy of achieving, you know, goals and things I'd set out to do. I wanted to just get out of England, I guess. not disrespecting England, but I still had sour, you know, taste in my mouth, you know, with Dad there, and I still living in that same place, you know, and I just wanted to get away from it. I wanted to come and start again. I wanted to play in the best league. I wanted to go to the next level and challenge myself again. And I just had to play good football and hopefully get picked up to play in the NRL.
I'm in England, it's 2009. Quite heavily involved in recruitment in those early years, you know, just making sure that we were actually attracting the right type of personality.
Two of the people who I valued an opinion on rang me and said, this kid's special, you need to get him. And fortunately for me, his manager or his mentor or is a guy called Chris Casely, who was the ex-chairman of Bradford, who I knew very well.
From Sam's point of view, going to the right club was so important to him. It wasn't all about the money, it never has been. It was a question of him going to the club that could best suit his career and his lifestyle. And the lifestyle that he wanted for himself.
Sam was talking at the time to go into Manly, and I rang Russell and said, Russell, you've got to have a look at this kid. We need to do something.
Nail, please.
Coincidentally, I was travelling to Derby to do 2 days of shooting in this valley, you know, with 800 horsemen or whatever it was.
I was playing for Bradford in Wales at the time, and I sat on the physio table getting a massage, and the phone rang, took the call, and it was Russell Crowe, and the conversation went, you know, I'm interested in talking to you. I've heard you want to come and play in Australia.
Sam rang me up one morning and said, I've just spoken to Russell Crowe. I said, go away. And he said, well, that's exactly what I told him.
I thought it was someone playing a prank on me. I thought it was one of the Aussie guys in the team. He sent me an email saying, look, you know, I want to catch up with you, I want to meet you. I'm filming in Derbyshire in 2 weeks' time, come down and meet me. Me and my mum drove down again to the movie set and to watch him act. Mum was actually pretty nervous and she was pretty excited, to be honest.
I was starstruck, and Sam was like, don't do this, Mum, don't do this, you can't say that.
It ended up being quite a wet day, and it was a bit of a long break in the middle of the day while I waited to see what would happen with the rain. And that gave myself and Sam and Julie Burgess the opportunity to sit down and talk.
We ended up just sitting in his trailer for 3.5 hours, just chatting about, you know, life, about family, about, you know, my ambitions, what I want to do, and where I want to go, you know, in Australia. And I said, look, I just want a chance. I want to play in the NRL.
So it's kind of like, you know, stories in front of the fireplace, you know? And the longer we sat and talked, the more I could see Julie relax.
He was very much wanting to make sure that as a family we were happy with it. It wasn't, you know, like we want to sign Sam at all costs. He wanted to make sure that as a family we were all happy with him coming over.
He put 20 cents in me and asked me to talk about South Sydney. I'll play all night, mate. I can tell you about all the heroes and all the good times. I can discuss all the shitty times as well. I wanted to let him know that I was dead serious and really into it. And there was going to be complications. I mean, he was still contracted to Bradford. Getting Sam Burgess out of his contract, it was going to be a lot of work. And I just wanted to just check his temperature and see if the types of thing we'd talk about had actually, you know, landed in his heart, you know? Not just in his mind, not just on the surface, but if it was something he was deeply engaged with the idea.
You know, it was never about the money, or I would have come for far less. I actually came for less money, you know, my first few years than what I was getting paid in England, just for the opportunity to come and play in Australia.
It's going to be my last chance of walking out on here, so I'm just going to enjoy it.
It was great timing for me to have that conversation with him. It was really as one of a group of young guys that we were trying to mould as a forward pack for the future, but also put together a group of guys who could all potentially be leaders and see which one over time stood up. So I could sort of say that I knew that about him, but I didn't know that about him. You know, I projected that onto him. I wanted him to be that guy, you know? I saw that in the way he played. I saw it in the way people talked about him. I saw it in the depth of connection between him and his mum. I saw it in the depth of connection between him and his mentor.
Will you be having some roast in Australia, Sam? Will you be having some roast? You think you'll be having some
if dinner? I can find someone to cook it for me.
No, I probably might do. I'll probably just get a barbie instead.
And I knew that they, you know, they knew him at a much more essential level than me. And everybody gave me the kind of energy about that, right? That he is the guy, you know? He can do that. He will work that hard.
Russell did the smoozing and did a great job and has become very close to the family now. And behind the scenes, I was working with his manager, Chris Casely, to bring him to Australia. So it was a joint effort and it's turned out great for the club.
I didn't actually realise I was going to land in Sydney on my 21st birthday. We flew into Sydney and I sat with Russell and he was actually excited.
He turned up to the club on the day. He trained. Then he did some media. And then in that meantime, somebody had told Shane Richardson it was his 21st. He was completely blown away. So Shane ran around and organised a cake and made a little birthday thing for him, you know.
And to have him on board at South Sydney was exciting. A lot of people didn't know Sammy at the time, didn't know what he was going to bring.
But that's essentially, that shows you who Sam Burgess is, that moment there, you know? He didn't arrive and, oh, no, give me a minute or whatever. He turned straight to the club. He gave everybody in that squad a real indication of who just arrived.
Sammy, please, can I get a phone?
Yeah,
sure. Dick Austin is a life member.
Just
Austin, good day, mate.
He's a life member of the
Rabbitohs.
Oh, yeah,
it's
good weather,
English weather.
English weather.
It's just the way he views the world, isn't it? He embraces life with his arms open, and I think everybody responds to that. He had a great relationship with his father through extremely trying times, and I think that has given him a type of education as well. I mean, you know, when I first heard about how he would carry his father to local football games, he became a hero in my mind, you know? And that stuff is in him. He's 24 years old, mate. He's got a heart like a lion. He's courageous, and he's a lot of fun to be around.
Cheers, cheers, cheers. Playing at Redfern, it was red hot. You know, he came down into the sheds about an hour before kickoff and said, Sam, come and have a quick walk around the oval. All I remember is he just pulled something out of his pocket and, you know, it's an honour to remember for my dad. And my dad used to say two lines to me before every game. That was written on the card, you know, my dad's membership card. It just caught me off guard and just hit me so hard. I burst into tears. I couldn't control myself, really.
His reaction was pretty deep, you know, and I possibly didn't expect it to be as deep as that, but I wanted him to know that he was connected here, that this is his family now, you know? So Mark Burgess every year has a membership and he has the seat next to mine at ANZ Stadium is Mark Burgess's seat for South Sydney home games.
It's just a really special thing and just my love for, you know, South Sydney and my love for, like, Redfern, it instantly changed from that day, just, you know, all right, I'm part of this club now for a long run. I feel a little bit emotional, you know, in a way, just overwhelmed by support that you're getting, you know, over here. So, man, I'm just happy to be here, just enjoying myself as a 21-year-old, you know.
He's very dedicated to what he does. It would take five freight trains to stop him from getting done what he wants to get done in his sporting career.
It's just a feeling that I've got inside me. It's really hard to explain. At the end of the day, I want to win a premiership with South Sydney. I want to be remembered at that club for years. And I suppose by doing that, you've got to dedicate yourself, your body and everything to the cause, and that's, you know, being the best athlete I can.
Great chance here for the Rabbitohs to extend the lead straight away. Diving out, planting it down. Sam Burgess has his first try in the NRL.
He came into a pack and he brought in that element of mongrel.
Oh, Michael Luck's just been gobbled up. He's been devoured by Burgess.
If you come through the middle, you're going to cop a hit.
They've got to try and get this one over the line. And good hits like that are inspiring.
That sort of energy and, you know, competitiveness, it definitely drives the club.
Everyone knows about the intensity of the NRL and the so-called step-up of the physicality of the game. But in the first two seasons I was here, I'm probably a little bit blinded, if I'm honest.
He's hurt himself, mate. He's hurt himself.
I used to put my whole body into everything. I guess I kind of pushed my body probably further than it's naturally supposed to go, and that's when it fell out.
The transition wasn't easy. I mean, he showed within the first couple of games that he played that he was a potential superstar of the NRL. But his body wasn't used to the type of grind, the type of contact.
He was probably a bit of a kamikaze player when I first got here, but that was just that effort. You know, he put everything into it rather than understanding, which in sometimes it was probably to his detriment.
There were some feet issues, there was a knee issue, there was a massive labrum tear in his shoulder. And lesser players would go into their shell. That didn't happen with Sam. Sam intensified his commitment on a week-by-week basis. And now he's starting to realise that potential that he has.
You know, I managed to get back out there and, you know, hopefully now I'm learning to look after my body a little bit better.
Right back when we took over, we had two sets of brothers in the team. I thought going forward, one plan could be to base the team around a set of brothers. You build a team, and as you build a sort of camaraderie in the team, you always talk about brotherhood, and I always believe that if you could actually embed a true brotherhood in amongst that rhetoric, that you could actually create something very powerful. The things that have to fall in place for four brothers to grow up in that way, loving the same sport, ending up at the same professional club, and then being in the same grade, on the same field, at the same time, was spectacular. And we're just extremely lucky they're doing it for South Sydney, because it's only just begun. It's only just in its very infancy, what the four of those guys, as their true and real brotherhood, will bring to South Sydney as a club.
What a night, a piece of rugby league history here at Allianz, with a 103-year-old record about to be equaled by four young supermen, the Burgess brothers, all 460 kilos of them.
Loads of messages from home today. I've been on a BBC talk show and loads of people from England. Everybody in England's really rooting for the boys.
Cheers.
Very, very proud moment. Very, very proud.
You know what? I'm going to watch this match. I don't normally do it, but I'm going to watch it in the players' enclosure because I want to be part of it. You know, I want to actually feel the total emotion of the night. They are really about what South Sydney is about with family.
First time in 100 years. We'll see it. We'll never see it again.
Right, they're just yet another fantastic members of the team.
Oh, how good are the Rabbitohs going with some pommies in there? Rabbitohs!
The Burgess brothers tonight emulating what the Norman brothers did back in 1910. Will we get to see them all on the field at the same time?
I was in the changing rooms with my brothers and we were about to go and warm up, and we sort of looked at each other and said, you know, wow, it's going to happen tonight.
Work though for Tedesco, and he did well. He's done extra well. Lovely run. 50-metre run then. And a professional foul.
Wow.
Sam's gone.
What frustrated me was because I didn't believe that I should have been Simmined.
I think they scored all their points when the sun was off, so in that 10 minutes.
Now he kicks to the corner. Simona's after it. He is a flying machine. Will he get them out? Simona's flying.
I felt awful because you're not allowed to sit at the side of the stadium. You've got to, I had to go up into the dressing rooms and watching TV, watching the game on a TV this big.
Thompson to Northaluma. Gets the ball inside. Murdoch Mitchell, Tedesco score. Give it again.
I'm watching my team on this great night. We're all playing together. You know, it's supposed to be so historical. And we're down, you know, 18 points after 10 minutes where I've been sent off.
It's been raked out. It's another try.
You know, I was really worried, if I'm honest. You know, we should be winning this game.
Here's Sam Burgess coming back down the walkway there.
I knew once we got back on that I still had 65 minutes in the game.
Sam's back on.
We just need to get one try back. That's all I was thinking. If we get one back before half-time, we're going to get the game.
And here's Isaac Luke spinning out of the tackle, getting it back on the inside.
This is when the Bunnies look at their best.
Takiri turns and chases. Farrell's after him. Oh!
Wow.
She just goes crazy. She has done ever since we were in the under-10s.
No! I do wear my emotions on my sleeve, which sometimes I wish that I could try and control myself.
No!
I'd messaged friends in England before that game and said, I'm going to try and sit still, I'm going to try and behave myself.
They're coming! Woo!
But I hadn't managed to do that, I'm afraid.
People next to her just have to cover their ears because, you know, she's uncontrollable, but, yeah.
They will head for the sheds. They were 18 behind. Now they're 6 behind.
Honestly, I never had any doubt that we were going to come back in that game, just the way it felt.
Sutton back to the middle. Reynolds put the kick in, came off the boot of Galloway. Tackle count restarted. Sam Burgess fending. He's over. Sam Burgess scores in front of Mum and the three brothers Burgess.
I think he was really keen to pay the side back after getting the 10 minutes in the bin. So he definitely did that, and he does it every week for the team. So
it was just great to see that determination that I've always seen in Sam, because that try was sheer determination, I think, on Sam's part to get them back in the lead again.
Isaac again, and through they go, and Luke Burgess, the 26-year-old elder brother, scores to give him and brother Sam a try in this memorable night. And there's Mum, Julie.
She got more airtime than we did.
Luke scored his try, because Luke hadn't scored a try in the NRL previously, and he'd just come on the field to replace Sam. And Sam was saying that he was in Sam's position, and if Sam had been on, he would have scored.
Sam just got a card and ran on. He's on too.
Memorable moment for South and the Burgess family.
So then when we got all on the pitch at the same time, it was just a great feeling.
Really special, yeah.
You felt you could do anything.
Look at this fella, George. Coming back like it was the first minute of play. Here goes Tommy. Now the four brothers are out there together.
I think one of us took the ball in, and the next player, we were consecutive, we all took it playing after each other, so
they've just had all five runs in that set of six.
It'd not been planned or anything, it just sort of unfolded that way, and I guess it shows the camaraderie and, you know, a great group of people that we've got in our squad to make that happen.
I think I was one of the first two into the tackle, and then the next thing I remember just getting bowled over. I think George was the last one to join the tackle, and we managed to force an error, which was pretty cool, and then that ended up being the last tackle of the game, so I don't suppose you could have written it any better, really, for it to turn out like that.
People talk of these once-in-a-generation type of players. The Americans call them a franchise player, the individual that can be a catalyst. They excite, they inspire, they light up the stadium. And you can appreciate their skill, but what you love is their determination. They're a magnet to other players, a magnet to the fans. The type of player that make other players realise their potential because they earn the right to dominate and they lead by example. And it's the nature of that person beyond the game itself That's the true distinction. The sparkly-eyed man who appreciates his life. You find a player who has those attributes, and you can build a dynasty.
Look, we dreamed of it as kids, and you know, for it to happen tonight, it's, you know, fantastic. And, you know, really proud of the family, but to be honest, mate, we've got a great team. That, you know, the team is our family, and that's what we're trying to build at this club.
Now they're singing.
Yeah, it's a marvellous time they're passing through for South Sydney fans.
I can't believe we've scored that try. That was the best thing ever.
Mate, it's a great feeling. Being on the field right at the end there, and that last tackle together was great.
Yeah, I'm just stoked to get that try, you know.
So it's 32-18, 32 unanswered points, 103 years.
This has been a production of Fox Sports.